The widow of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo links embattled lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. to dozens of killings in the province.
Authorities recover high-powered firearms after raiding the property of former Negros Oriental Governor Ryder Henry Teves, the brother of Congressman Arnolfo Teves Jr.
The Philippines and China agree to address maritime issues through dialogue.
And Ukraine prepares for a counter-offensive in Bakhmut as Russia's assault grows weak.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. Grave accusations from the widow of slain Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo against controversial lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. Pamplona Mayor Janice Degamo says she personally knows dozens of killings in the province linked to Teves. She says some of the cases involved land grabbing. Teves, who has been suspended 60 days for his continued absence from Congress, has also been linked to the murder of Governor Degamo.
There is something wrong with this man. And we don't want a person na talagang may mga unruly behavior at may mga you know, cruelty na ginagawa sa mga tao na patuloy na magre-representa ng isa pong distrito. Yung iba, yung reason, pag pinapatawag nila at pinapatransfer nila ng political loyalty, and if they get refused, they do something bad to these people who refused them.
When you say bad, but what do you mean bad? How bad is it, ma'am?
Ay, yung iba namamatay talaga. Maglalaro yan sa 20 to 30 people.
Mayor Degamo adds the complaints were included in the letter she sent to the House of Representatives as she seeks Teves' expulsion from Congress.
Yung result po ng suspension, I was told, this is the first time na talagang nasuspend ang congressman at lahat ng mga kongresista bumoto para sa suspension niya. That is something already. Meaning they have sensed that there is something wrong here and that someone has to answer. Or according to us po, hindi po kami titigil doon sa suspension.
The Philippine Justice Department is validating the claims of Governor Degamo's widow. Secretary Remulla says, based on their own records, there are already 17 cases allegedly tied to the Teves camp. But he notes more names are coming up.
As I said, we have to build up cases, we have to get the data, we have to investigate them systematically to get the necessary data and to have a case folder for each. So we know who are the witnesses and what statements will be made to support the allegations. So we're looking at a group of people, an organization within Negros Oriental that is possibly involved in this. Maybe a group of 7 to 10.
6 new suspects in the killing of Governor Degamo underwent inquest proceedings at the Justice Department Thursday. The DOJ also confirmed all 10 suspects in their custody are seeking government protection. The agency has yet to assess their request. It also hopes to file cases against the suspects before the month ends.
They know that they have no other recourse but to have their families protected, and we are willing to do that because they're very important to the case at hand. For them itself, it's very hard to know if they will be under witness protection later because we cannot discharge anybody as a state witness at this point in time because we're still getting the whole story straight.
Other news, a former operator of offshore gaming in the Philippines reveals a scheme involving the alleged selling of Chinese workers to other pogo firms. Nico Bawa has his special report.
October 19, 2021, the Philippine National Police entered the office of Benistar, a licensed pogo operator in Zapote, Las Piñas. According to Ruth Pomposelli, the former operator of the facility, the police were looking for 6 Chinese workers who were victims of human trafficking. but she was surprised when several other employees were made to leave the building and brought to the Las Piñas police station. She says the PNP did not show her any documents of the police operation.
Sabi ko, sir, nasaan po yung papel? Ano po yung pangalan ng reklamo? Ano po yung identity? Wala rin silang formal na binigay.
According to Pomposelli, ever since the police operation, she has never seen her employees. She says she was only able to track them when they were brought to the DSWD shelter in Mandaluyong. She was not able to get hold of the employees and instead, she received a complaint for trafficking.
At hindi lang yun. You know what confused me? Nawawala yung mga tao ko. As in, nasaan? And then I found out na benta sa ibang POGO operator.
In a separate forum, Pomposelli says she tried to speak to some PNP officials so she can take back her employees. But she was asked to pay ₱500,000 for each employee.
Bago pumasok ang mga e-workers sa ibang employer, may utang na kaagad sila na 600,000.
Yun.
Yung mga workers na yan, pipiliti nilang magtrabaho.
Non-stop daw ito pa yun. Slave labor.
Yes, magiging slavery. Kung gusto mong umalis sa akin, lahat ng binayad ko sa'yo, lahat ng mga inano ko babayaran mo. Ngayon kung walang pambayad, tatawag sila sa pamilya na sa China, sa kaibigan. Kailangan mong bayaran yung ginastos.
The complaint against Pomposelli was eventually dismissed. However, she claims an official initially tried to ask 20 million from her for the case dismissal. The PNP denied her allegations.
That's very unfair to the PNP for her to accuse other PNP of doing that. Siguro he should start naming names so that these people that he will be naming, they can also defend themselves.
The ground commander in the raid explained that it was the Chinese embassy who sought for their assistance and they were accompanied by the DSWD in the rescue operation to find the 6 trafficked Chinese workers. He claims the other employees of the POGO insisted that they be rescued as well, which is why they took them into custody.
Pagkakit namin, nung nagkakandak na inspection yung ating City Social Welfare and Development Officer, nagulat kami, yung mga empleyado nila, nagbabaan na at gusto nang umuwi. And na-overwhelm kami. Gusto nilang umuwi na at ayaw na nilang magtrabaho. So, in-extend din namin yung aming tulong dito sa mga empleyado na to.
He also explained why Pomposelli was not allowed to speak to her employees.
Every time na nakikita nila yung mga yon, ng mga victims na na-rescue natin, bumabalik yung trauma nila. Sila mismo nagre-request na kung pwede, hindi sila makausap.
Pomposelli and the PNP also had a different headcount on the number of rescued workers that night.
58 lang siya talaga. So we have the records. We have dun sa police station, may records tayo. Hindi ko alam kung bakit niya sinasabing 72.
According to the DSWD, 6 of the employees escaped from their shelter. The remaining 52 workers were discharged last December 2021 and were brought to their relatives in Manila. The PNP doubts if the workers were sold after they were released, though they admit that this has happened in some cases.
All expenses paid ng company, yung accommodation mo, lahat sasagutin ng company. So siyempre, bilang investor, ang makabawi dun sa investment mo. Siguro kung hindi sila maging effective or hindi sila productive para mabawi yung ginastos nila sa'yo, yun yung parang sigurong kanilang option.
According to the data gathered by the ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group, out of the 111 victims in crimes involving POGOs from January 2019 up to September 2022, 71 were cases of kidnapping and 40 others were human trafficking. Majority of the victims are Chinese nationals. More than 80% were rescued by the police. The others paid ransom or escaped from their captors. This data does not include cases from other units from the PNP and the NBI. Kidnapping and trafficking aren't the only illegal activities that have involved POGOs. Others were involved in online scams. Nico Bawa, ABS-CBN News.
Police raid a property owned by Pride Henry Teves, the brother of embattled lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. Michael DeLiso joins us on the line with that story. Michael.
Hi, Ron. Authorities have seized high-powered firearms and ammunition from the property of former Negros Oriental Governor Pride Henry Teves in the province. Philippine National Police, or PNP spokesperson Colonel Jean Fajardo, said Criminal Investigation and Detection Group raided a business compound of the former governor located in Caranoche, Santa Catarina town by virtue of a search warrant order due to a supposed violation of the Comprehensive Firearms and Ammunition Regulation Act.
Ng warrant ay yung pong HDC Bayawan Agri Ventures na kung saan ay base po sa records po ay ang tumatayo pong presidente po dyan ay si Mr. Henry Bright Teres.
Three people were held under police custody and authorities say they will check if these individuals hold a license to own and possess firearms. The recovered weapons will be submitted to the Firearms and Explosives Office to verify if these are registered to PNP's database. Pride Henry is the brother of embattled Negros Oriental Representative Arnolfo Teves Jr., who is facing multiple criminal complaints over a series of murder in 2019. The lawmaker who is overseas is also being linked to the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Roel de Gamo. Police earlier raided the properties of Congressman Teves, where several firearms, ammunition, and explosives were also seized. It was not clear if the recent raid was connected to the issues involving the lawmaker.
Meron po tayong isang impormante na lumapit po sa PNP na nagsasabi na ito nga pong compound na ito ay dito po itinatago at meron pong pag-iingat ng mga high-powered firearms na makikita po dito po sa loob.
And that's the latest from Camp Crame. Back to you, Ron.
Thanks for the report, Michael Deliso.
Meanwhile, Congressman Arnolfo Teves Jr.'s lawyer challenges the accusers of his client to prove their allegations in the proper forum. Let's get more details from our correspondent, Vivian Guria. Viv?
Hi, the lawyer of Negros Oriental, 3rd District Representative Arnolfo Teves Jr. challenges those hurling accusations against his client to prove them in the proper forum. Attorney Ferdinand De Pastra said, allegations should be raised before a criminal investigation agency or the ombudsman instead of Congress. The camp of slain Negros Oriental Governor Roel de Gamo said it is considering filing an ethics complaint against Teves over the latter's alleged links to numbers game like small town lottery and isabong. According to the lawyer of the Gamo family, attorney Levito Baligo, this is a violation of Section 14 of Article 6 in the 1987 Constitution, which he added could serve as basis to expel Teves from the House of Representatives. De Gamo's widow, Pamplona Mayor Janice De Gamo, also claimed that Teves was involved in some 20 to 30 killings in Negros Oriental. Janice De Gamo sent a letter to the House of Representatives calling for Teves' expulsion, citing the complaints he is facing over alleged illegal possession of firearms and a 2019 killing in Negros Oriental. House Security or Secretary General Reginald Velasco said the letter could eventually be referred to the House Committee on Ethics and Privileges. Should it happen, De Pastra urged the committee to give Teves a chance to be heard. Meantime, the camp of Teves also asked the House Committee on Ethics and Privileges to defer the implementation of the sanction on the lawmaker. That's at least until they hear Teves' explanation and his continued unauthorized absence from the House of Representatives. The lower house unanimously voted on Wednesday to slap a 60-day suspension against Teves over disorderly behavior. In a letter emailed to the committee on Friday, Teves' lawyer appealed that the suspension be lifted and Representative Teves be allowed to participate in the sessions and discharge his duties as member of Congress virtually in the meantime. The Pasha asserted Teves did not disregard Congress's authority, as shown by his request to extend his travel clearance and later his plea to go on a leave of absence. But these were not granted. Delta Pasha says Teves requested to participate in the committee hearing via video conference due to alleged serious security threats, which was also disallowed. Back to you.
Thanks, Viv.
Moving on, Malacanang says Sugar Regulatory Administration Chief David John Tadeus Alba stepped down due to his worsening health. His resignation will be effective April 15. It comes amid a fresh controversy on the recent importation of 440,000 metric tons of sugar, which was supposedly allocated to three hand-picked importers. Alba replaced then-SRA Administrator Hermenegildo Serafica, who quit over another controversial importation order last year.
The Philippine Agriculture Department assures the public the smuggled sugar set to be sold in Kadiwa stores is safe for consumption. The agency plans to sell around 80,000 sacks of sugar confiscated by authorities in recent weeks. Agriculture spokesperson Christine Evangelista also says monitoring in ports has been intensified to prevent smuggled agricultural products from entering the country.
Yan po'y dadaan sa mga test, kaya po kasama pa rin natin ang Sugar Regulatory Administration, because as the regulating agency po, we have to ensure na we are very, very sure na ito po talaga ay safe for consumption. So hindi po naman po ito basta-basta na ibebenta, meron pa rin pong food safety protocols na ating i-observe.
Let's now bring in Rosendo Soy, the chairman of SINAG o Samahang Industriya ng Agrikultura. Mr. Soy, good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon, Ron.
Sir, we want to get your thoughts on a couple of issues. First, on the resignation of the SRA chief. Now, this resignation comes 7 months into his job. He cited health reasons, but this comes amid another controversy at the SRA. What do you make of this?
Yeah, I think the administrator should declare those smuggled sugar and smuggled, and this should not be solved. We think that this is smuggled sugar, so dapat hindi lang pwedeng hindi dapat ibenta.
Mr. So, balikan ko yung, ano, yung mga na smuggled na sugar na yun. Pero dun sa mga resignation dun sa SRA, tingin niyo po ba, hindi ho ba kayo na napapaisip na nagugulong operasyon ng SRA dahil sa mga pagre-resign ng mga opisyal nila?
Yeah, in first place, dapat ano, nagsalita kagad si Administrator Alba na, oh, illegal yan. Once and for all, tapos yan. No? Ibig sabihin, gumawa ng statement dapat, and para at least hindi umaba yung storya. And dapat yun ang action na ginawa niya.
Bakit?
Kasi maski may go signal yan sa kay ES, pero wala naman ano, wala naman sinabi ang executive secretary na hindi kukuha ng permit. Ang importante, dapat kasi every import have to have a permit. And yung SO number 6 lumabas yan, and nandiyan yung sugar. No? Dapat ano, nag-apply muna yung tatlong applicant before na pumasok yung sugar.
Tingin niyo ho kaya may connection tong pag-resign niya dun sa kontrobersyang yun?
We don't know, but dapat firm ang action ng ano, administrator.
Okay, mapunta po tayo doon sa mga na-confiscate na smuggled na asukal, no? They're going to be sold in Kadiwa stores. You are against that. Bakit ayaw niyo po yung mangyari?
Yeah, first is ang essence ng Kadiwa, dapat bumili sa ating mga local na magsasaka, local producers, and para at least matulungan ang ating mga magsasaka, no? Maparating ang ating mga produkto sa mga taong bayan dito sa mga Manila and other area. So kung ito is smuggled, dapat talaga hindi ibenta sa Kadiwa. Yun ang nakikita natin. And lalo na ito ay smuggled goods. Hindi maganda yan na kasi ang Kadiwa is ang ng presidente is to promote yung mga produkto natin sa ating local produce, mm-hmm, para makarating sa consumer.
Pero hindi nyo ba naisip siguro po na ang gobyerno ay medyo naiipit din? Kasi pag yung asukal na to ay binenta naman, ang magbe-benefit naman dito ay mga consumers. Because when you mix in that sugar that they confiscated, it's going to bring down the prices. And it's the consumers who are going to benefit. But at the same time, sugars from the local producers or sugar from the local producers are still going to be sold in Kadiwa stores, which is going to benefit the farmers. Hindi ho ba parang middle ground? Walang, may middle ground po ba na pwedeng makita dito?
Yeah, we think na dapat yung imported na dumating last year, ang imported na sugar dumating last year is 650,000 metric tons. No? Ayun, dapat binenta ng 70 pesos. Pero hindi pa rin nangyari. And dapat in-implement ng SRA na yung import will be lower price. Dahil ang puunan, nakita naman natin, is 35 pesos lang.
Mm-hmm. Pero dito po sa smuggled sugar, ayaw nyo talaga, wag na ibenta sa kadiwa stores, wag na ding ipakalat sa ibang markets na para mabenta.
Yes, we don't think na kailangan na galawin yung itong mga smuggled sugar at ibenta sa ano, kasi mamaya sasabihin nila pwede pala yung sugar sa susunod other agri product ibebenta na rin. So we don't think na kailangan na gawin justification na confiscated ito, dapat ibenta sa kadiwa.
Mr. So, nabanggit niyo po yung presyo. Bakit po ba mataas pa rin ang presyo ng asukal? Nabanggit niyo na rin na ang dami na nagpasukan na imported sugar dito sa bansa natin. Why is it still high? And what is the situation of the sugar supply in the country?
Yeah, Aaron, we think na dapat palakasin no yung local production natin, na in which kung makita mo yung flooded last year ang bigas. We imported 3.85 million metric tons last year, in which ito is 3 times yung volume na pinapasok natin ng 6 years ago, di ba? So hindi rin bumaba yung presyo ng bigas natin, di ba? And kung makita natin yung baboy, almost 3 times din yung volume na pumasok, yung manok, 2 times yung pumasok. Hindi rin bumagsak ang presyo ng retail price. So, ang nakikita natin is mas maganda pa rin kung mas malaki ang local production natin. Ito is mas hindi kontrolado lang ng ilan-ilan. And mas mapapababa natin ang presyo kung itutok natin yung local production.
Pero yung nasasabi niyo po is parang pang long term, ano, pag pinalakas natin yung local production natin. Meron po ba kayong rekomendasyon kung paano natin mapapababa kaagad ang presyo ng asukal?
Kasi ang palaging inisip ng NEDA is short term, sasabihin nila, no? Pero kung makita mo yung short term, hindi naman nila pinababa yung presyo ng baboy at manok. Dati sinasabi nila pag pumasok yung import, babagsak ang presyo. Pero kung makita mo, hindi bumagsak ang presyo ng karne ng baboy, karne ng manok. So hindi solusyon, no, yung importation talaga. Dapat kumita ang ating local produce, dumami, at ito ang nakikita lang natin na mas may chance na bumaba yung presyo.
Mr. So, yung bigas daw po, malapit na rin mag 20 pesos per kilo. Nakikita nyo bang mangyayari na to sa mga susunod na buwan o taon?
I think very clear naman yung statement ng ating Pangulo. Pangarap na we hope na he's hoping na mapabilis yung pagbaba ng presyo. Of course, lahat tayo gusto natin mababa yung presyo, no? Pero yung inputs mataas pa rin. Yung fuel from 29 naging 80, naging 68. Pero yung harvest natin ngayon, siyempre based on yung harvest natin, mataas pa rin yung pataba at that time, yung December time, January time, no? So ngayon, pababa yung world market ng pataba. Pero ito is tatanim pa lang ng June, July. So ito, makikita pa lang natin next December na medyo bababa yung presyo ng commodities. Sa ngayon, up to end of the year, hindi pa natin makikita yung pagbaba. And yung target na 25, we hope by next year, aabot na tayo ng 25 to 27.
Okay. Lastly, Mr. So, another impending problem. We have the Bureau of Animal Industry warning of a pork shortage in the market in the coming months. That's because of the African swine fever in the different parts of the country. Now, we do know yung mga local governments po may mga ginagawang regulasyon para matigilin yung pagkalat nitong African swine fever. Ano pong tansyan nyo sa national government? Kulang po ba ng programa para mapatigil na yung pagkalat nito?
Ron, kung makita mo, no, for the past year, 2019 up to now, yung policy ng DA hindi napababa yung spread ng ASF. Mm. And ngayon, after Mindanao, tinamaan pa yung area ng Bisaya. Oh. Diba? So yung protocol nila talagang malaking problema dahil yung first border natin up to now, hindi nila pinapansin. Kasi ito is, alam naman natin yung first outbreak nangyari sa Rizal is from imported meat. So, maski tayo kano ka strict doon sa local na produce natin, kasi every time na lumalabas sa mga piggery, may testing sa mga ano yan, sa atin na Bureau of Animal Industry. Pero walang nangyayari dahil yung imported papasok lang na in which wala silang testing. Yan ang sinasabi natin. And nakita natin yung protocol na nangyari sa Luzon. It takes mga 3 years bago ka aalisin sa red zone. No? Mm-hmm. So hindi ka pwedeng na mag-repopulation dun sa area. So talagang mahirap. And ang tingin natin, mas maganda ang local government ang mag-handle yung province kasi kasama nila yung local racer na nag-gumagawa ng testing. So sa tingin natin mas maganda na lang yun kaysa gusto ng yung national government na gawin yung procedure nila.
Okay, Mr. Rosendo So, the chairman of CINAG. Mr. So, thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks.
The latest now on the worsening oil spill in Oriental Mindoro. Philippine authorities now considering tapping military divers to assess the scope of the damage. Justice Secretary Remulla, who's part of the interagency response team, says they are in talks with the Civil Defense Office for the deployment.
We want divers to come down to be able to calculate the rate of spillage to the ocean, to know how much oil is pouring out of the tanker. And we asked the OCD to mobilize some of the divers from the armed forces.
Some 23 villages in Calapan City are now under a state of calamity. Officials say more than 3,000 families in the city are affected.
Meanwhile, Oriental Mindoro is set to begin processing compensation claims for oil spill affected residents. Governor Humerlito Dolor says residents can start to file their claims this Monday. He appeals for patience, though, with the processing of claims seen to take up to a month. The province estimates at least 30,000 families have been affected by the disaster.
Hindi po kinakailangan dumagsak sa Kapitolyo simula sa Lunes. Maaari pong hintayin nyo na lamang ang pagtatayo ng claims office sa inyong lugar. Ito po'y panimula para lamang siguraduhin
Opo.
Na sa pakikipag-ugnay ng pamahalaan panlalawigan, ang inyo pong mga claims for compensation sa mga damages ay magkakaroon na po ng katotohanan.
The mayor of Cabuya, Laguna orders the temporary suspension of all school fire drills in the city. That's after a routine fire drill sent over 100 students to the hospital. Cabuya Mayor Dennis Sain said some 3,000 students were ordered to stay inside classrooms for over 3 hours while in cramped conditions during the drill. Temperatures at that time reportedly ranged from 36 to 43 degrees Celsius. When the students were eventually let out, they were sent to an open field where they stayed for another 30 minutes under the scorching heat. The mayor says some students passed out while others experienced seizures.
Hindi po namin yun alam. Nalaman na lang namin nung tumawag sa akin yung barangay chairman ng barangay Mamatid. Pagbaba lahat ng mga bata sa mga batang estudyante sa designated evacuation area na open ground, naarawan yung mga bata. Then I asked the principal, bakit kako may nakuha kaming reports sa mga reports na pinagbabawalan ninyong magsuot ng sombrero or magpayong yung mga bata samantalang napakainit. Then the principal answered na sabi niya gusto namin kanya maranasan nila yung kung papaano na sa isang tunay na sitwasyon ng sunog.
Medyo nagulat lang din po kami kasi ang dami po eh. Yung unang pagkakita po namin sa kanila, nag-hyperventilate, tapos yung iba dehydrated, hirap sa paghinga, kaya po dinala agad namin po dun sa may resuscitation area, tapos kinabitan ng oxygen.
A senior Philippine diplomat asserts the need for a peaceful resolution to the country's maritime row with Beijing. Foreign Affairs Undersecretary Teresa Lazaro made that position clear during the final day of the dialogue between the two countries.
Maritime issues continue to remain a serious concern to the Filipino people. Additionally, both our countries' leaders agreed that maritime issues should be addressed through diplomacy and dialogue, and never through coercion and intimidation.
China's Vice Foreign Minister Sun Weidong echoing that remark. He also hopes for more consultations with the Philippines on their long-standing maritime issue.
We need to properly deal with these issues through friendly consultations. This points the direction and provides the guidance for us to deal with and solve maritime issues between the two countries.
Up next, Paris shrouded in chaos as anti-pension reform protests continue.
And TikTok CEO faces a grueling questioning by U.S. lawmakers. More news when we return.
Others. The Pentagon announced on Thursday that an unmanned vehicle of Iranian origin struck a coalition base. In response, U.S. President Joe Biden authorized a precision airstrike on facilities used by Iran-backed militia groups. The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights reported that the strikes killed 8 pro-Iran fighters, though the Pentagon has yet to confirm the number.
Ukrainian troops gear up for a counter-assault in Bakhmut as Russia's winter offensive loses momentum. In a social media post, Ukraine's top ground forces commander says Russia's Wagner mercenaries are running out of steam and they would be taking advantage very soon. His remarks are the strongest indication yet that Kyiv is close to shifting tactics. There has been no immediate response from Moscow. Ukraine, which had looked likely to pull out of the city, decided this month to keep its troops there, denying Moscow its first victory since last August. North Korea says it has tested a new nuclear-capable underwater attack drone that can generate a radioactive tsunami. State media reported the new North Korean drone cruised for over 59 hours and detonated in waters off its east coast Thursday. It added the weapon is intended to make sneak attacks in waters and destroy naval striker groups. Pyongyang has carried out an unprecedented number of missile tests in the past weeks, blaming the joint military drills by the U.S. and South Korea for raising tensions in the region.
Chaos all over France as anti-pension reform protests continue. Protesters burned piles of trash and set off firecrackers in the streets of Paris during the sixth consecutive night of violent protests. Now, this stems from the government's move to raise the retirement age by 2 years. Over a million protesters have taken part in the demonstrations across France, with 120,000 of them marching in Paris alone. Emmanuel Macron's government barely survived a no-confidence vote over the unpopular legislation. His allies are also warning him against continuing business as usual amid the protests.
The CEO of video sharing platform TikTok admits some U.S. data remain accessible to TikTok staff in China as he faced intense grilling by U.S. lawmakers. But he insists there is no evidence these have ever been accessed by Beijing. More in this report.
Back, the head of the massively popular video sharing app TikTok on defense Thursday as bipartisan calls to ban the app or severely restrict its use gain momentum.
TikTok collects nearly every data point imaginable, from people's location to what they type and copy, who they talk to, biometric data, and more. Even if they've never been on TikTok, your trackers are embedded in sites across the web. TikTok surveils us all. And the Chinese Communist Party is able to use this as a tool to manipulate America as a whole.
CEO Xu Zichu said the app is a place for free expression, and his company is working to safeguard data stored in locations in the U.S. and Singapore.
I have seen no evidence that the Chinese government has access to that data. They have never asked us. We have not provided.
Lawmakers concerned that TikTok's parent company, ByteDance, is controlled by the Chinese Communist Party.
The combination of TikTok's Beijing communist-based China ownership and its popularity exacerbates its danger to our country and to our privacy.
Global security experts contend the app could be a national security disaster.
TikTok is programmed to be weaponized. And if China can weaponize a balloon, think of what it can do with 150 million TikTok users at its mercy in the U.S. alone.
But Chu sought to refute those claims.
ByteDance is not owned or controlled by the Chinese government. It's a private company. 60% of the company is owned by global institutional investors. 20% is owned by the founder, and 20% owned by employees around the world.
China says the U.S. has yet to provide any evidence the app threatens national security.
The U.S. should stop spreading disinformation.
And not all U.S. lawmakers agree with calls for a ban.
And TikTok as a platform has created a community and a space for free speech for 150 million Americans and counting.
TikTok will soon be banned from all U.S. government devices. The White House saying this week it's carefully considering a nationwide ban.
We understand the popularity of TikTok. That is something, we get that. But the president's job is to make sure, again, that Americans' national security is protected as well.
New bipartisan legislation would not outright ban the app, instead giving Biden increased ability to regulate and sanction social media companies.
We have a free market economy. We have a constitution, a bill of rights, and the rule of law. And so when we go about a process like this, it has to be orderly.
A TikTok ban could be deeply unpopular with many younger Americans, a factor lawmakers may consider ahead of the 2024 elections. Catherine Gibson, VOA News, Washington.
Stocks in Asia capped the week in negative territory as investors weighed new remarks from the U.S. Treasury chief. Philippine shares, meanwhile, bucked the regional downswing. This report.
Asian equities saw choppy trade Friday as banking concerns continued to cast a shadow over the economic and market outlook. Investors also digesting modest rate hikes and commentaries from several central banks, including the Federal Reserve and the Banco Central ng Pilipinas.
View has been and continues to be that the recession risk is still there. It was delayed, but not eliminated. And now
Moody's Investor Services Christian de Guzman says, despite the positive data at the start of the year, risks are generally still tilted to the downside, with more scope for downward revision in sovereign risk rating. He also thinks a BSP pause is coming soon.
What you did see, of course, is that there is a linkage. I wouldn't say that they're moving in lockstep with the Fed, but there is a need to also look out for different things, not just domestic conditions, but also global capital flows. So maintaining perhaps an appropriate interest rate differential that will help to sort of temper capital flow volatility in and outside of the Philippines to stabilize the peso, that also is a key tool towards actually managing inflation. The Philippines does import a lot of energy goods, for example, also a lot of food. BSP has a good track record over that has been accumulated over the past 10 to 15 years. So I think we can get there without too much meaningful sort of breaking the back of the economy.
Philippine shares getting a boost from a possible pause in the rate hike cycle. The PSE index jumped more than 1% in Friday trade to snap a 7-week losing streak.
To be honest, if you could see, if you broaden the scope a little, year to date, we're back to square one. We're about, I think, 20, 30 points up only for the first 3 months. And that's both positive and negative, given all the externalities and the headwinds that we've had to contend with.
Mm-hmm.
And in terms of looking forward, maybe for the next couple of weeks, slow news, no news might be good news,
right,
to be honest, because that means that a lot of the concerns, and especially on the global scope, the global economy and the banking fears that have been planned with the Credit Suisse debacle and everything, which has since calmed down because of the merger with UBS, is something that it's a positive takeaway.
Nisha Alacer of DA Market Securities also sees more healthy consolidation ahead.
There is an obvious consolidation, and that in some cases you'll see already higher lows. And so although we can't really call that it's going to be more bullish, let's say, in the short term, we do, however, think that a healthy consolidation, this pause that we're that's happening, is indicative of what could come next.
This is a medium-term hold. You know, we're here to build a pipeline, and it's really, we have a pipeline of projects over the next 3 or 4 years,
mm-hmm.
and it's not a one-day blip or one-day rise.
Meanwhile, renewable energy firm Alter Energy braved the market volatility to make its debut at the PSE. The newly listed company says it's bullish about the prospects of energy transition, though it admits the shift will take time.
Power plants have operating life of 20 years, but I think the good thing about Alter Energy is that it's an inflation buster, Mimi. You know, we can already deliver long-term rates fixed, much lower than the grid rate today, with much lower than coal or gas prices. It'll be done over 20 years at 5 pesos per kilowatt hour, plus or minus. Hydro can be done closer to between 6.5 pesos. And wind would also be around that level. Now, the wholesale electricity spot market went up to the roof lately as oil and coal prices went through. They went up to 8 or 9 pesos a kilowatt hour.
Meanwhile, the T-led GT Capital posts a 67% jump in 2022 full-year consolidated net income to 18.4 billion pesos, as all units enjoyed strong growth, except for Toyota Motor, which took a hit from the rapid and steep depreciation of the peso against the dollar last year. Finally, SM Prime is set to apply for a permit to sell the fifth tranche of its fixed-rate bonds of as much as 35 billion pesos, with maturities of 2.5, 4, and 6 years. This is part of the company's 100 billion peso shelf registration from 2020. After this, there will be around 25 billion left. Consulting firm Accenture has announced it will cut 19,000 jobs, or about 2.5% of its workforce, as part of cost-cutting efforts. Accenture cited significant economic and geopolitical uncertainties that had impacted its business. It expects to save up at least $1.5 billion from the downsizing. The job cuts will be gradually implemented over the next 18 months.
Sports now. Filipino-American Eric Spoelstra becomes the fourth coach in the National Basketball Association to secure 700 career wins with a single franchise. As Steve Angelus tells us, the Miami Heat coach plans to visit the Philippines in time for the FIBA World Cup.
It was a pair of milestones in an eight-day span for Filipino-American Miami Heat head coach Eric Spoelstra. On March 13th, Spoelstra's 697th regular season win pushed him into 20th place for all-time coaching wins. While on Wednesday night, he racked up number 700 with a 127-120 win over the New York Knicks.
This was a big-time collective effort. We knew we were going to have to do things well on both ends of the court and have to make plays.
The win comes as Miami tries to secure a top six standing in the Eastern Conference. Miami has eight games left on its regular season and is beginning to heat up, winning seven of their last 10 games.
But right now for us, more than anything, we kind of have to win to be where we want to be. But I like it like that, you know, playoff game, every possession matters.
After the game, the two-time NBA champion met with 2022 U.S. Tennis Open girls champion Alexa Ayala, who recently competed in the Miami Open. Spoelstra will head to the Philippines in the summer once the NBA season is done, just in time for Manila's hosting of the FIBA World Cup. USA Men's Basketball Managing Director Grant Hill recently shared with international media the Team USA's plans and the excitement of heading to the Philippines. The five-time All-NBA team member and Hall of Famer recalled a pair of visits to the Philippines, including a meeting with former President Corazon Aquino.
It's incredible the love for the game of basketball that exists in Manila and in that country. I had the good fortune and opportunity in my former life, back in 1996, to visit Manila. And It was absolutely incredible. I was absolutely blown away in Manila. And the thing that was amazing was that she was an avid basketball fan. So she knew about Detroit. She knew the Pistons. She knew, it was absolutely incredible. And so I'm sure you know this as well, but I just think the fans and the passion and the love of the game will be on full display, this upcoming summer, much like it was or more than it was back in the mid-90s.
Team USA will stay in Manila throughout the duration of the World Cup. Hill said Team USA will announce its roster in late June, most likely after the NBA championships. Steve Angels, ABS-CBN News.
A zebra becomes an internet celebrity in South Korea following a three-hour-long adventure outside his home, the Seoul Children's Grand Park. Mitsero, the zebra, the three-year-old escape artist who managed to give zookeepers the slip. The internet was abuzz as Sero roamed the streets of the South Korean capital Thursday. Sero's trip was cut short, though, after he was cornered by park wardens and brought back to the zoo. And before we go, the ABS-CBN Foundation, Sagip Kapamilya, and Bantay Kalikasan teams are gearing up to help our kapamilyas in Oriental Mindoro in the aftermath of the oil spill. These operations are only possible because of you. And here are the ways to donate to the ABS-CBN Foundation. You can send them through our bank accounts or just scan the QR codes flashed on your screens. Donation vouchers are also available on Lazada and Shopee. And international donors can send help through this PayPal QR code. We can get through this because we are here for one another. Thank you for your support, Kapamilya. And those are the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.